The second video about my CNC spark erosion machine introduces one fundamental improvement and some other details I've implemented. The minor improvements include a microservo operated switch that allows the electrode to be used either for spark erosion or for measuring. The polarity between the workpiece and the electrode can be changed using two 12V 40 amps relays. The new pump is taken from a car's windshield washer system. A piece of foam acts as a simple filter which has proven surprisingly effective in operation. Let's take a close look through a microscope at a drop of the brownish liquid circulating in the machine. You can see that the majority of the particles is significantly smaller than 50 micrometers. However, since these particles clump together relatively quickly and sink to the bottom, the water jet after the filter is relatively clear. Also, I'm using a press tube as the electrode in this test, the flushing water is not pumped through it. Directing the water jet onto the electrode from the side is the technically simpler solution. Firstly, it allows for significantly lower water pressure and secondly, the electrode rotates, which would require a coupling that can withstand this higher water pressure. Since I don't currently need exceptionally smooth surfaces, my simple filter with tap water is sufficient. I consider the ability to rotate the electrode to be a fundamental improvement. This reduces the likelihood of it welding to the workpiece, allowing the feed rate to be increased. You can see that the sparks are generated in a faster sequence than was seen during drilling in the first video. Especially when the electrode has gone a little deeper into the steel, you can see that the drill head shakes whenever a temporary weld is broken by the rotation. Welding can be further minimized with better process parameters, more on this in upcoming videos of the series. You can also see that the drill chuck wobbles. It was cheap and the 12mm steel tube I pressed in as the shaft is not perfectly vertically aligned. Since I use a stepper motor to drive the drill chuck, my first idea was to at least partially compensate for the wobble by software. To do this, one pin on the microcontroller is configured as digital input and connected to the electrode via the servo switch. The runout can now be measured at a reference point, which I demonstrate here with an intentionally bent electrode. And yes, this too is just a few quick and dirty lines of code with an inadequate reference point made from materials that happen to be lying on my video table. At least you can see how it would work in principle if it were implemented better in terms of hardware and software. You can see that the wobble is at least partially compensated for by software generated movements along the x-axis. As always, having a more precise mechanics and a straight electrode is better. Another disadvantage of the cheap drill chuck is the clunky mechanism which has to be operated with a tool. Therefore, I ordered a smaller drill chuck, which is screwed onto an aluminium tube with an 8mm outer diameter and 2mm wall thickness via an 8x0.75mm thread. Here a new sieve for my plastic grinder is being made from 0.75mm sheet metal with the mini drill chuck. The larger holes with a diameter of 3mm are needed to mount the sieve on the grinder. The circular motion required to drill holes with a diameter larger than the electrode diameter appears chaotic. The reason for this is that the movement occurs quickly if no spark has been generated within a specified interval of 60 milliseconds. However, if a spark occurs, the electrode remains at that point until a spark pause of 60 milliseconds has elapsed. The holes of the sieve, each with a diameter of approximately 2mm, are drilled with the same electrode. A tool change is not necessary for different hole diameters. The tungsten electrode erodes less and also welds less frequently to the steel sheet than is the case with a brass electrode. I still need to do a bit of experimentation with material combinations. The sieve holes are drilled without any circular motion along the XY axis. The electronics and software are not yet optimized for spark and short circuit detection, which negatively impacts the machining speed and the measurement of electrode erosion. What looks frayed under the microscope is definitely sufficiently round and smooth when viewed with the naked eye. At least the M3 mounting screws fit easily into the designated holes. Due to the poor runout of the drill chuck, deviations in the diameter of the sieve holes are still noticeable, but the result is sufficiently good for the intended purpose. So back to OpenSCAD, and version 3 of the clamping device for the electrode is the most economical. Two small parts from the 3D printer center the electrode inside a 8mm diameter brass tube. Two M3 screws hold the electrode in position and conduct the current towards the workpiece. The result is a runout so perfect that the wobble is barely noticeable to the naked eye. The next component I'm making for the grinder is a new blade. To minimize the imbalance of the rotating blade, the holes must be centered as precisely as possible. Therefore, the length and width of the steel are first measured using the electrode. After that, the voltage of the welding inverter is applied to the electrode and the steel is machined. If you're in a hurry and have good drill bits, you can only mark the positions of the holes with the electrode to a depth of just 1mm. Sometimes, however, the right drill bit isn't handy, and then even slow in-house prototyping is faster than getting new tools. The material being cut is 3mm stainless steel. In terms of software, I've still implemented the points to be traced directly into the Arduino sketch. Quick and dirty, but it works perfectly well for my purposes. Before I even think about making the software more user-friendly, I have some more hardware changes to test. At the top of the list are different voltage sources for the spark gap. Currently, a welding inverter with an idle voltage of 64 volts at 10 amps is used. However, I've already ordered power supplies with voltages of 12, 24 and 48 volts. In combination with a power transistor, better control over the energy transmitted by the sparks should be possible. There is still plenty of potential for innovation with this affordable CNC spark erosion machine. If you'd like to support me in my efforts to further develop this technology, besides the build instructions, there is a donate button on my website. Many thanks to everyone who has already used this button or who has donated through other channels such as the Super Thanks on YouTube or via Patreon. Thanks for watching and I'll be back!